where I work. That's our goal, to empower whomever or whatever. If we work with individuals, families, or communities, etc., when we leave, they should be empowered. So transformation can only happen when that community is organized. I said, would have been wonderful if we had gone into Ferguson right away and organized that community to be more effective, to reach goals, to be able to say, okay, now we're going to have committees or whatever that are going to know what outcomes we're looking for. How do we make transformation? How do we make change and go about it efficiently and effectively? So I think that that is a piece that we're missing in our field. And very few, if any, schools or departments of social work have a community organizing and development track, right, which really needs to be in place. Other piece I thought about, I don't live very far from here. I can get here in 10 to 15 minutes. And I come up Lawson. Everybody knows where Lawson is, okay? So when I come up Lawson, I pass Durham Tech, go a few more blocks, and what do I go through? MacDougal Terrace. Everybody knows MacDougal Terrace is rep, even though it's not the type of projects I grew up with. I grew up with high rises, all right? Like you went in there, you could get in, but maybe you couldn't get out. Projects. So I said, there's MacDougal Terrace. I go two more blocks, and what do I come to? Come to Central. I say, something's missing here. What's missing? We talk about Black Lives Matter, and there's no doubt. We had the discussion earlier, so I won't go through that one. How do we become proactive? It's better to be proactive than reactionary. Because when I'm proactive, I have a better chance of determining my outcomes. You follow? Mm-hmm. I don't want to, you know, just say, if I can just have a piece of the pie, I'll give you a piece of the pie. I determine how big it is. I'm going to have most of the pie. I don't want a piece of the pie. I want the flour that makes the pie. Mm-hmm. At least the flour that makes the pie. Because you ain't got no pie if you don't have flour. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
Now I have something. We want to negotiate. I have something you need. I'm not asking you for a damn thing. So this is a challenge I put towards y'all. My challenge is to push, and however you do it, that I think the university should have a satellite center right there in the Dougal Terrace. And I understand they just bought the land. So what? It's a metaphor for anywhere in the country. I've been on many college campuses. I went to the University of Southern California for my MSW, right in the heart of the Black community. Right in the heart of the Black community, University of Southern California. Pepperdine was in the heart of the Black community until they moved out to the coast. You go Columbia University. Where is it? Heart in the Black and Hispanic community. Name them, and just about all of them are. The vast majority of colleges and universities, including HBCUs, are in the heart of the Black community. Where are these satellite centers? You with me? In order, so those are the people that we supposedly working with. If we had some satellite centers, and then we're supposed to have the top brains and activists in the country. You have an activist here right in the law school, Joyner. Everybody know him? He's the head lawyer for Moral Monday. You know, when you get ready for Moral Monday, Al comes and gets you out.
Okay.
It's nice to know the lawyer that gets you out of jail.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The law school of education, that's a nice pretty bill. School of education, law school of education, and whatever other schools need to have a collaborative that come together and provide services right there. So we're talking about families. Yeah, a lot of families are single parent families.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that there cannot be critical males in their lives. Right? What you have now that's happening is that the requirements to matriculate in community colleges, or junior colleges that I call them in California,
the requirements and the standards to go out. What does that mean? Come on. It means fewer and fewer of us are going to be able to go to college to get an A. But interesting enough, for the last number of years, the community colleges and the four-year universities and colleges have been working on a seamless transition from the community college into a four-year college. It means the courses that you took at the community college will now all be accepted at the four-year university. Mm-hmm. That's important. So, fewer people get in junior college. Mm-hmm. Fewer people going to be able to make that transition to the four-year university. We talk about Black Lives Matter. That's a holistic concept mm-hmm. and perspective. They matter on the emotional level, on the physical level, on the spiritual level, and as they talked about earlier, educational level. So after school programs that really teach, we talked about earlier here, self-identity, cultural identity. Who am I? Where did I come from? Mm-hmm. We talk about DNA literally go. What is my concept of myself? What is the history of people of African descent in this country? I need to know that. I need to know a deep appreciation of how that struggle has been from the times, I said 1619 when I was brought over here from the ship, but understand that my culture existed long before my existence here in America.
Yes.
Right? I start buying books because I'm saying, I'm not going to, if you destroy the libraries that were in Mali, Aminifu is going to have a library. Okay? So, that's the identity piece, part of it. I can work with families because I have to change the view of the world. And if you view of the world, like my brother said, who's now 62, he said, I didn't think I was going to live to be past 22 years of age. And I'm saying to him, you didn't even hang out on the streets. I hung out. But I thought I'd live a long time. I mean, I hung out. Even when my parents said, you can't go out, I said, okay, that's cool. I snuck out. I knew how to get out of my house and get back in before they woke up. All right. But if he thought that he wouldn't live past 22, right? What about the average or low income that grows up in the Google Terrace? What's your perception of the world? Do you feel like most of us don't do certain things now because there's certain things we have too much to lose.
Mm-hmm.
You follow what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. If you don't have anything to lose, you're a dangerous person to yourself and mm-hmm. others in your community.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? And we know that. And I'm doing a piece and I'll talk about it a little bit on the psychological or psyche of police who abuse and kill. Okay? There's a certain psyche, especially mm-hmm. when you're white and to black. But our intervention needs to be proactive so that we go in and help them become a better psychological understanding, have a belief and see themselves 35, 40 years from now. I mean, I'm an old man, I see myself 20 years from now, but I'm still good. I've still got a good 2 minutes. Can't take somebody out 2 minutes in. Let's just be there, right? Everything else works too.
Okay.
So, I think it's in so that you help, and then the schools do not teach from the cultural perspective that most black children have. But it's not only cultural, it's also physical. Most black children and most black people are right brain. That's more creative, but when you look at how the educational system, it's more left brain. Mm-hmm. So that's a whole other piece that I don't have time to go into. But in Duplin County, I worked with some people from Chapel Hill, and we were training the administrators in Duplin County to be trainers to be more effective in the paradigm to teach black children. You with me? Because there's a whole other way.
Mm-hmm.
You go to school when you're 5 years old, the teacher says, sit there with your hands. What are you talking about? And outside, running around.
That's right. Go outside and play. Play hopscotch, you know, double dutch, all that.
Yep.
Now, 5 years old, the most curious part of my whole life, read Amos Wilson's Psychological Development of Black Children. Right? You know who Amos Wilson is. Y'all should take some notes now, because I'm so teaching class. You with me? Mm-hmm. Amos Wilson, you got to read Amos Wilson's work. He talks about psychological development of black children. And he's using all white researchers and force that the children develop earlier in terms up to 2.5 years of age. So now, I come to school and I'm supposed to sit there at this desk. And I'm just excited about learning. And Amos Wilson? Yeah. Excited about learning. Oh, you're hyperactive. You have attention deficit disorder. You're talking about I'm trying to explore the world. You know what I'm saying? My mom told me, don't buy your children a whole lot of things. Just bring them in the kitchen. Let them break them with pots and pans. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Look at some of the games that historically we learn our children. Gross motor skill development, fine motor skill development, through interaction. From a Western perspective, learning is supposed to be basically cognitive. From what in terms of Afrocentric or Eastern perspective, it is holistic. You with me? So that now we have children who are not doing well in school, but they come to an after-school program that I work with, and the learning is interactive, and they do real well. So they're two different models. And when so that I'm saying that part of the, I don't know whether they're getting this in the courses that are being taught here, but the material is there. Read Hale's book. Hale, what's her first name? At Google, what's Hale's first name? I'll try to think of it. You know, that looks at learning styles of, look up learning styles of black children.
Mm-hmm.
Last name's Hale. So that this after school program can help children learn from a way that's more conducive to their learning styles so that they do well in school. I ran an after school program when one young boy was absent 60% of the time from school. We worked with him and he got on the honor roll and there were no absences. But you have to learn how to function, as Chastain and Norton talk about, who are social workers in this classical work, that there's a dual piece in our lives. One is where you go and you interface in terms of educational systems, work, et cetera, and the other way you come home and get nurtured. So I'm pushing y'all to push the university to say that we need a satellite center. And you can do your internship right there. You can do your internship right there. And change systems, work with families to empower families as a group. That's why I like the Settlement House Movement. Everybody familiar with the Settlement House Movement? Because the Settlement House Movement said, okay, we're going to sit right here in the heart of this community. It was mostly for immigrants, but I think you've had Iris Carter when they come. And you know, part of her presentation is looking at the history of social work by black individuals who were the historical folk. And that settlement movement, he had over 500 black settlement houses throughout the country. Right in the heart of the community. And the volunteers actually lived there. But what they did, okay, so they taught reading, writing, arithmetic. They taught English because people need to know how to spell English. You need not spell English, speak English. But we also need to be, it's okay to have Ebonics at home, but if you're going to function out there, because you're going to be judged by the way you talk. I've been stopped by the police so many times, I don't know why. I was driving my little Jaguar I had one time with my hat on backwards, and I'm coming from D.C., right? All of a sudden, the cops pull me over. Yeah, I know what to do. My hands are right here where you can see them. What do you want? Oh, I know what you want. You want my license and registration. Here's my license and registration. And this is the way you see them. All right. And my license and registration. And of course, they run a bank. But it is how you talk to them. Not just the words you use, but your enunciation and pronunciation. Right? They give me back. I never ask somebody to stop me because they're not going to tell me.
just go on. But I can name many, many times I've been stopped. One time my oldest daughter's mother wanted me to go pick up her mother, which is my daughter's grandma, from the airport and her two friends. Now, once again, I'm back to go pick them up. They were old enough to be my grandmother. Right? Now I'm picking them up. I'm driving my car. The airport police pull me over. I'm saying, now what they think? Maybe they think I'm looking so fair. I'm a white man in the car with these three sisters in the back, and I'm a pimp. But the only way I could have been a pimp was I was taking these three women to the senior old days home, right? Because they, I don't know, license registration. Then I'll go ahead. I can name many, many times. Okay. So I understand. So what I'm saying is, though, but if you learn both languages, you learn how to function so that people external don't misjudge you. Are you with me? It's not one answer to this whole piece. It's a whole bunch of answers. Mm-hmm. But you have to be able to articulate. Now, when I come home, that's different. If you want to call it slang, you want to call it. But Ivanis is officially, is technically a language. It meets all the requirements of a language, okay? All right. So, I really challenge you to push this university. I don't want to hear that there's no money. Go write grants. There's lots of money out there in grants. You know, you find money. There's money out there in grants to do that. That's the field placement. Right? Because this program, the master's program here, was started as social work and juvenile justice. You with me? It's our responsibility to be proactive in our field. And there are jobs in our field in justice. So any of you thinking about being court counselors? That's it. They probably pay, well, I don't know what jobs pay well here in North Carolina.
I used to be one they don't pay well.
Yeah, but nothing pays too well, man. You know, so you there doing the day, you get a part-time job. I tell my friends, you know, it's also work. You know, first of all, I live all right. It is like, how much hustle do you have? Hustle and flow, right? How much hustle do you have? My friends who are lawyers, they get to work by 7:30 in the morning and work until 9:30. All right? It's just like working two jobs. You put the same amount of hours in. So we go to one job, you know, Department of Social Services, and then in the afternoon we get a part-time job. Yeah. We'll be all right. We'll be okay. Invest your money well. Don't the first time you get a paycheck go out and have to buy Mercedes, okay? Buying your children $200 pair of shoes. Okay. But I mean, you get the chance to write reports in such a way that they can be helpful. Helpful for the people, the judge, to understand some of the dynamics that this child faces, right? Also, when I say help the judge, you'd be surprised how that begins to influence how the judges think. How people in that whole court system think. And then there's probation officers for adults. So if you're in human services, teaching, what North Carolina amazes me. It was the third lowest paying state in the country for children. I mean, for educators. Damn, no wonder nobody. No, that's a whole other thing. Okay, so I look at the profession that we're in, and we have to look at the opportunity that we have to influence systems. So my piece, and if you look at, for example, there are models out there that look at how you can get into communities and work. SNCC has a model in terms of how you organize in the community. If you look at the UNIA, everybody know the UNIA is? Mm-hmm. Universal Negro Improvement Association. Mm-hmm. I remember an article that got published that's looked at the Universal Negro Improvement Association. You've all heard of Marcus Garvey? Mm-hmm. Okay, that was his organization. That look at it as a social service organization. Look at provide housing, jobs, all the things that a culture does to take care of the welfare of people. Right? And you have to look at it from a positive
positive pro-African perspective. And the reason why I say that, sometimes people who are outside of one culture or another do not understand the institutions within that specific ethnic or national culture or nation or that ethnic group. Right? You know, I look at the Nation of Islam. A lot of people have problems with the Nation of Islam. I grew up, I had a problem with the Nation of Islam because the fruit made sure there was peace. You understand, the fruit of Islam, that was like, we called their own. When the fruit came in, no drugs. They walked into the projects, all the drugs were gone. It mattered less to us what the ideology was around religion. That wasn't our primary concern. Are you following what I'm saying? That institution that came in, when they came in, they could get rid of all the crime and it'd be a safe place to be. That's what we were interested in. We knew we weren't going to be converted to the nation, but we might support the Nation of Islam in terms of looking at it from a social perspective. You follow me?
Right.
So that different cultures look at different institutions from a different perspective. But when you live right in the heart of that community, you're interested in your safety. That's one of the primary pieces. When I work with families, they said the first thing we're interested in is the safety of our children. And I can understand it. Because I had to look for somebody one time who threatened my family. I mean, I was just going to say, would you please not threaten my family? So, I want to make sure I cover some of these things that I spent. I really wish that there was a representative from the police department here. I'm not here to beat anybody up, but let's face reality. I get it. You can go online, and there's this report, the title, Killed by Police 2015. The days. From 2013 to 14, that's a list of all the people who were killed by police in this country. That's outrageous.
Yep.
I mean, look at all, I don't know, there are thousands. Okay? So there's something the matter. So I start looking at, haven't been a psychiatric social worker, so I haven't done anything easy. Okay? What's the mentality of people, especially police, who abuse and who kill? Being a police person is a dangerous job. It's a dangerous job. I commend you for being a police person. Most police are okay. The majority of police are okay. But there's a segment that you better watch out for. Segment. Right? So, and I'm looking at, and the vast majority of black people who are killed by police, vast majority are males, and they're usually killed by white police.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, there are police who work in a community who hardly ever run into any problems. And this is the cultural piece, the dual culture. Western culture, which our system's mostly built on, are built on authority. By the position you're in, it grants you a certain authority.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if you base how you relate, what was it? The detective here on campus talked about relationships. If you base how you interact with people on purely your authority, it's like playing big whiz. Most of the time, if you play your trump ahead of time, you're in trouble, all right? Most of the time, not all the time, but most of the time. You don't have any trump left towards the end of the game. So if you base your relationship with the community purely on your authority, when the community doesn't accept your authority, that's the conflict. I mean, you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
So we come out and cops and it says, first you respect me as a human being. You have to respect. Just because I'm alive, you gotta respect. The history of the police force goes back to slavery. Any of you watching the series on TV called Underground? Alright.
Underground?
Isn't it called Underground?
It's not Underground.
Underground? Okay. Yeah, it comes on a Wednesday night at 10 o'clock. Almost at my bedtime. So, the slave catchers, you know what I mean? The ones who enslaved were in the red. I don't like calling them slaves, I always call them kidnapped Africans. When kidnapped Africans ran for their freedom and liberation, it was slave catchers. Mm-hmm. And they call them rogues, right? Who would come at them. But if you trace the history of police in this country, it goes all the way back to them.
Mm-hmm.
They became sheriff, Ku Klux Klan members became sheriff, etc. And the police in this country really were to enforce and keep poor people, no matter what your ethnicity is,
mm-hmm.
and blacks in particular, oppressed.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you have a course that specifically on black folk, especially if you're going to work from a psychiatric or a psychological perspective, you got to read Why Blacks Kill Blacks by Poussin. Right there. Right? Why Blacks Kill Blacks by Poussin. Black Rage by Cobbs and Greer. Mm-hmm.
Black Rage from who?
Cobbs, C-O-B-B-S, and Greer, G-R-I-E-R. They're classical in the field. And the person, I guess the ultimate person you really have to read is Fran, F-R-A-N, Fanon, F-A-N-O-N. I don't know how he did it. Where did he die? He died before he's 40. He's a psychiatrist, right? So you have to go to med school, and then you have to specialize in psychiatry. He fought in the Algerian Revolution, one of the wars he fought in.
He writes these two massive books.
One called Black Skin, White Mask. Black Skin, White Mask really talks about how you identify with the enemy, your oppressor, and you want to become just like them, which means that you wind up oppressing your own.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's that Black Skin, White Mask, in a nutshell, when you read it, little tiny, you know, letters. Mm-hmm. And then the other is The Wretched of the Earth. Those are two classical books that help you understand the relationship historically that people of African descent have had in America. Mm-hmm. That was my point. Hey. So those begin to lay the foundation for beginning to understand the relationship. So now, if you look at some of the killings that have gone on, Staten Island, the brother who was selling Lucy's, you know, cigarettes, Lucy cigarettes, and Big Brother choked him to death.
Mm-hmm.
I take some martial arts. That's a chokehold that can take you out in a couple of seconds. That chokehold can take you out in a couple of seconds, let me tell you. And it was against police regulations to use. Staten Island. Understand Staten Island. Staten Island historically has been, am I going over? Let me know when my time's up.
Are you done? Are you Hudson?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How many more minutes could you spare for us?
I'll take about 5 to 10 more minutes. I think. Right. Staten Island was classical, traditionally a white working class community. All white working class community. That was Staten Island. Now it begins to change ethnically. Blacks come in, Hispanics are coming in. You have some diehard people have two fears. One, the fear that America is being taken over by people of color.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This is our country. I don't know why y'all be coming here. Okay, you got that piece. Okay, that's a real fear. And the fear, come on, y'all psychological people, is a projection that y'all will do to us what we did to you.
Yes.
And it ain't true.
Yes, no, it's
okay.
Not.
The other fear, so you have police who have some of these same apprehensions and fears and believe in the myth that exists about black folks.
Right.
Lazy, don't want to work. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not saying that there aren't people in the community, but there are people everywhere.
Right.
Well, some lazy don't want to work.
That's,
you know,
right.
That is, nobody has a hole on that, but the majority of people do work. I saw this brother of mine who lived in D.C. at the train station. He would get up early in the morning and play his saxophone at this train stop and stay there. So he was there when people were going to work, when the trains opened about 6:30 in the morning, and stay there until rush hour was over, until about 8:30 or 9 o'clock at night. Man, I'm begging. He's a musician. You pay to go see musicians play. You go to the clubs. He's saying, just drop some money. I'm playing. That's work. That's a lot of work. And he played out there in the cold. You follow what I'm saying? Understand Gordon's definition of work. So the mentality of police, one, they're mad because they think you're taking over the country.
Mm-hmm.
Then they're scared. Mm-hmm. Scared of black men. You follow what I'm saying? All sorts of myths. You got all sorts of myths about us. We angry, we mad, we can all fight. That ain't necessarily true. We say we all dance. Mm-hmm. Oh, I can. You know, there are myths out there, but I believe so. When I come into an encounter with a black male, all these myths shoot through my head. I'm scared, I'm fearful, I want you to recognize my authority, and I'm saying to you, I'll recognize your authority if you treat me with respect. If you don't treat me with respect, take the badge off, drop the gun, come on, this is what goes through the mail hands anyway. Come on, and let's do it one-on-one. So that all this comes in at the same time. So I no longer see you as a human being, I see you as a threat to my existence. And I need to blow you away. And the fraternal order of police, they need to change. Because they support anybody who does anything, even when you break the law. They need to become more objective. Yeah, support them if the person has, you investigate and you find out it was a justified shooting, killing. If not, then you know you shouldn't, at least should not be supporting them. And you should do some other things too to make sure that they get a trial, a fair trial, but they need to go to court, just like that state trooper that got sentenced just recently for shooting an unarmed man. And the first thing you're going to say, because this little boy has his toy gun, you don't run up and shoot somebody, right? You don't even give them a warning. Come on, you got a laser, you got a, I shoot, right? I shoot weapons. You got 15 rounds in a Glock 9, and you're taught to shoot here.
Mm-hmm.
Police are, but everybody is. That's where you're targeting. If you go to range and shoot, you shoot from here. Because why? Because that's the biggest target. Mm-hmm. You got to be real good to shoot somebody who's going to the base. I mean, you have to be a real good, you know, marks person. So it's that fear, it's that anger that comes out. And those folks, every policeman who's on the force knows those crazy dudes. They know who the crazies are.
Mm-hmm.
They know who the crazies are, so they need to step up. We fought so we would get black policemen, but black policemen to represent us.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about being fair and just.
Because mm-hmm.
some of the brothers were out there doing some crimes now.
Mm-hmm.
But some of us don't get caught all the time. You know? But that doesn't justify killing over some material thing.
Mm-hmm.
You follow me? Now, closing, sort of closing piece. But a couple of weeks ago on the news, police were talking about boycotting Beyonce's
mm-hmm.
concert. Well, first of all, Beyonce, what's her husband's name? Yeah, he lost that weight for her too, didn't he? You had to put something on his. Oh boy, slim down real quick. They have enough money between them to get their own police force,
mm-hmm.
the concerts. But you're upset at Beyonce for this image that she projects about Black Panther Party.
Right.
Understand the existence of the Black Panther Party in Oakland, California in the 60s. Oakland, all Southern LA. I got stopped in Southern LA. I've been driving a little Mustang, you know, had a Big Apple hat on. And all cop pulls me over. You know what they say, let me have your registration and your driver's license shown to him. Went back, they had computers in the car, saying, as they do now, but back then they had. He said, oh, here they are, don't worry, you won't get stopped again. You had a regular make on me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But you, LA went after all Southern ex-military for the police force. Talking about in the late 60s, early 70s.
Mm-hmm.
Oakland, the cops were just totally outrageous. They just stopped you for anything. Get a piece of balls. The law says that you can observe policemen if you're so many feet away. you get in your car and leave, we were told, okay? But there are programs. In Oakland, California, for example, some black policemen got together and started a little league, like baseball team. But they expanded it because they wanted to build relationships with the families in that community. They would start providing services for the families in that community in addition to the Little League baseball tutorial services, etc. Crime rate has gone from here to here because
mm-hmm.
everybody in the community knows who's committing the crime. They know who's selling the drugs. They know what house the drugs coming out. They know what kind of drugs are being sold, etc. As an example. So the crime rate goes down when you establish a positive relationship. You follow what I'm saying? When you establish that kind of positive relationship, crime goes down. So mm-hmm. how do we come together? I am not sure. But I do know there has to be an earnest, non-blame, but it has to be objective. And I think whenever you're in a position of authority, there's a concept in social work that we talk about, equality and inequality,
mm-hmm.
right? The more authority I have, the more responsibility I have to the person who has less equality to change that system so it becomes fair. You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that system, that police system, has the responsibility to train people more effectively on how, and maybe the social workers need to do this, that's why I say maybe you need to get into those systems, how to establish positive relationships in the community. You cannot initially just use your authority to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You have to come in and respect people. You have to get out the cars and walk, okay? Yeah, you're going to run into some stuff. You're going to run into some stuff anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But your job becomes less dangerous the more positive your relationships are with people in that community.
Mm-hmm.
I ran a program called my agency that I founded called My Center for Human Organizational Enhancement. And we went into the project where it was an after-school program. We had a van. We went in all over the city. And we just talked to the dudes hanging out on the street. What y'all here for? We explained what the program was. We were picking children up for the after-school program, teach them life skills, etc. When we would pull that van up, all the dudes are hanging down the street. We said, don't worry, I'll go get a little quick food. I'll make sure that he comes. We got what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
You with me?
Mm-hmm.
When I was more active in the program, I was, had become an administrator. And I worked with the young guys one day, if you know, D.C., it's M Street, right? Downtown M Street. I'm walking downtown M Street. This car pulls up, and about four young boys jump out and start coming toward me. I said, damn, I ain't got nothing on me either. They said, Dr. Harvey, how you doing?
Hmm? Wow.
You understand what I'm saying? They were like, they wanted to see me. They wanted to tell me how their lives were going.
That's awesome.
Hmm? When I worked in the stockade, ran the stockade, I was not a pushover. But I was fair and I was just.
Mm-hmm.
I went to the same places the dudes went to when they got out of the stockade or before to hang out, right? Lieutenant Harvey, don't worry. Anything happens, we got your back, bro, because I was fair and just. I'm not bragging on me. I'm talking about when you're fair and just with people, you get respect. Mm-hmm. And you get respect. That's better than having somebody like you. We all been in here and we've had romantic relationships with folks. Then after 2 months it's over and But if they respect you, that, that lives forever. That's the piece where police have to get to.
Mm-hmm.
That's the place where we as social workers have to be more effective to make sure that our young boys and families do not put themselves in a position to interface with these killer police.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you gotta put, and when you build, what I liked about Settlement House, and I'm closing on this, is that everything was done in groups. Everything. The sewing clothes were done in groups. Recreation was in groups. Because it's groups where you have the power.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they don't identify any one person. I often thought, what would happen now? And you talk about Chris, right? I had an earring ever since the boy is about. You people use this about the old crib. But we did some work in LA when they first started. And we went and we talked to the police and we were meeting with the beginning of the Crips, before the Bloods, beginning of the Crips. And the police said, yes, we're willing to work with them. Except we go into the meeting and the police totally change. So, but wouldn't it be interesting to get these young brothers and sisters organized and we go. The county commissioners, one of them was sat right here. You know how much their budget is a year? Their budget is $500 million a year.
Mm-hmm.
To go, young people go, organize, have a plan of what they want to go with, to build recreation centers that are fully staffed. There's a Boys and Girls Club, but I don't know how them young people get there. Mm-hmm. Right down there for drivers and, was that Pettigrew? And you're driving this nice club, they probably do nice things. But if you live here, how do you get there?
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So there need to be recreation centers right in these communities. So young people need to go and say,
yeah.
You don't respond, you won't be in office next year. Because we're going around and organizing the community to vote. Right? And now, we're developing the evaluation. Y'all smart, right? Y'all research. We do evaluation research, help them develop the evaluation tools to give out every year to everybody in office. Okay? Mm-hmm. Evaluation tools based upon how it enhances the community that they're in.
Okay.
And you got the media. The media wants anything that, you know, sell the newspaper. They don't do the evaluation tool, you send it to the media. You have a radio station right here, mm-hmm. independent radio station. Not owned to anybody except for what I donate every month to. You follow what I'm saying? So it has to be this. Don't wait for somebody to give you the pie. Go get the flour. So ain't no pie without the flour. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Don't have to beg. What's amazing about our culture, I'm looking at the end of slavery, right? Emancipation Proclamation, 1865. Urbanly, what was it, 1909? Urban, NAACP, mm-hmm. all those organizations. I think too often we have the expectation somebody going, well, James Brown said, don't give me anything, I get it myself.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And you have the models for it. You have the UNIA, you have all those models out there. And if you're not, if the course content doesn't have some of what I talked about, you as students demand that it be there. You demand, no students, what? Ain't no program. You have the most power that you will probably ever have in your whole life right here. Y'all walk out for 2 days. Y'all walk out for 2 days. Of course they're going to try and bluff you like, you better not walk out. That's why there is no one person that is identified as a leader. You go, you have to meet whomever it is, the director, whatever, or the president of the university, you go as a group. They want to meet with you individually. You say, we don't go. We don't go. Ain't nobody want no bad news around this time anyway. You know what I'm saying? Understand the power you have as a people, but you better sit down and get your strategies and tactics correct and know what your goals are. Yes, we would like something different. I'll give you something. What you want? Want a piece of cake? You know what I'm saying? If you don't know what your goals in there for, I'll give you anything. I don't want to give you. Don't give me nothing. Myself, understand that you as students understand this for your whole life. You have power.
Mm-hmm.
Just same thing when I talk about foundations and think they're giving you some money. Understand they have to give a certain percentage of their gross, of the money they have,
they have to give a certain percentage every year, or they lose their nonprofit status. You just have to figure out how you get in so you give one of the people who get some of the funding, but they have to give it up. They don't give it up. And if they lose their nonprofit status, what happens to them? They got to pay taxes. The corporation that they're part of have to pay taxes. Those foundations came into existence. One reason, not the only reason, sometimes those very humanitarian reasons, but some of it was so they wouldn't have to pay taxes. And there are jobs in foundations. I used to consult with the Annie and Casey Foundation. They paid me almost as much as I was making on my regular salary. I'm coming. Understand? So, and the other jobs, let me just talk a little bit about jobs. People say you can't make any money in social work. We touched on that before. I live well. I sent three of my children went to college. Two of them came out and didn't know a dime. Now, when they decide to go to grad school, they take out student loans. I tell them, you want to take out all that money in student loans? You know you all like shoes, right? You will not be able to buy a pair of shoes, much less a house, if you want to take all that money. It's not free, okay? So the jobs in the foundation world, they're jobs for community organizers. Trade unions love social workers who have been trained as community organizers. So you're in a field, and this is my very last remark, guaranteed. Who was the first social
worker? Jane Adams. Who? Not Jane Adams. It was during the Progressive. No, it was my.
What did you say?
Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right.
That was bad somebody.
That's right.
So people say to you, you tell them you're going to do the Lord's work.
That's right.
Or Allah's work, Shaniki's work, the creative force. But look at Jesus Christ. Who did Christ hang out with?
That's right. The lowest of the low.
They were the disciples, they hung out with the large people. Understand, Christ was a revolutionary.
Yes, he was.
Christ was a poor Jew who was under Roman rule.
Yes.
So if you want to be whatever you want to be in terms of religion, but if you have to be Christian, which is the biggest, you know, religion in this country, then you need to be a follower of Christ. But you need to understand Christ and know who Christ was.
That's right.
Christ was a bad hush of mouth.
Yes, he was.